Hello dear students, I am Professor Poonam Gharge. Today we are going to learn the remaining part of plant genetic resources. In previous lecture, we have studied the definition of germplasm, then kinds of germplasm, types of seed collection, gene pool classification system, etc. In this lecture, we are going to see the germplasm conservation methods and activities. So already we have studied definition of germplasm. Okay, so can anybody define me? Yeah, so germplasm is nothing but it is the sum total of genes in a crop species, that is referred to as a gene pool or genetic resources or genetic stock. Okay, so gene pool refers to the whole library of different alleles of a species. So why there is a necessity to do a conservation of germplasm? So first thing is for getting a food security as well as to maintain a agrobiodiversity, we have to go for a conservation of these PGRs. Then another thing is valuable source of compounds. This germplasm or whatever plant species you have conserved, that will be proven as a valuable sources of compound which is required in the medical industry, food industry, crop industry or crop protection industry, etc. The next one is breeding of new and more productive crop as well as resistant to biological and environmental traces through selection is only possible with this germplasm. If we are not having this parental material or basic material, we can't progress with selection method and we can't develop a high yielding varieties. So for that purpose we require conservation of these plant genetic resources. And the next one is maintenance of ecosystem. In order to maintain a natural habitat as it is, we have to do a conservation of plant genetic resources. Then another thing is loss of genetic diversity among crop plant. So due to civilization or modernization, what happened? We are doing a deforestation as well as agricultural land is also going to be converted into urban areas. That result in the loss of genetic diversity and some species become extinct due to this high rate of industrialization. So in that case, in order to maintain those species for future need, we have to do a conservation. The next one is human dependence on plant species. So we people are majorly depend on the plant for our food as well as for building building. We require a material such as wood and other things, then oil, lubricant, rubber and other latex, resin, waxes, perfumes, dye, fibers and medicines. All these we are getting from a plant. So for that purpose we have to do a conservation of the species. Then species extinction and many other problems that are going to threaten and endanger the plant species. So some species are nowadays not present on the earth due to this deforestation or any another method. So for that purpose we have to avoid this extinction, we have to do a storage or we have to do a conservation of those species. Then great diversity of plant is needed to keep the various natural ecosystem functioning, because on this plant not only human being but other organisms are also dependent, and for that purpose we have to maintain a diversity of plant in order to give survival to other ecosystem. The next one is losses of genetic diversity. So here you can see there are several reasons we are having which create or which will bring loss of genetic diversity. So first of all is, you can see here, that is a destruction of natural ecosystem. Okay, so due to deforestation, what happened? We are destroying the natural ecosystem, that will result in the loss of genetic diversity. The next one is human socio-economic changes. Okay, then natural calamities such as flood, earthquake, that also result in the extinction of plant species. Then pollution due to natural as well as artificial activities, that will also leads to the destruction of plant species or extinction of plant species. Then exotic weed species, that also create a problem for the survival of our another species. Then over exploitation of forest for fuel wood, timber and medicine. So on large extent, if we are going to do the harvesting from the forest, it will also result in the loss of genetic diversity for many purposes. Then changes in agricultural practices and land use. Nowadays we are shifting our cultivable land into civilization purpose. So that will also result in the extinction of plant species. Okay. Then next, activities that is conducted in germplasm collection. So there are mainly 6 activities carried out which is related to germplasm conservation. In that, the first one is exploration and collection. Second one is conservation activity. Third one is evaluation. Fourth one is documentation. Then multiplication and distribution and utilization. Last one is. So one by one, those activities we are going to describe here in detail. In that, the first one is exploration and collection. So exploration refers to the collection trips. Okay. Or it is also referred to the tapping of genetic diversity from various sources and assembling the same at one point. So we are, exploration means we are just visiting several places and we are collecting the different plant species in the form of seed or in the form of plant parts, etc. And we are assembling all those material from several places at one place, that is called as a exploration. The next one is collection. So collection is essential to reduce the loss of genetic diversity due to genetic erosion and extinction. So in exploration and collection, there are six important points or aspects are coming, that is source of collection, then priority of collection, the agencies of collection, methods of collection, then method of sampling and sample size. So one by one we are going to see all this. So first one is sources of collection. So there are 5 important sources of germplasm collection through which we can do a collection of these species. So first one is the centers of diversity that we have already studied. It may be a Wavilon center or Harlan or maybe mega center, etc., etc. Through you are visiting, by visiting those places you can do a collection of large number of plant species. And next one is gene banks. So you can visit the gene bank and from there you can collect the germplasm. The next one is gene sanctuaries, which is maintained at tribal areas. Then seed companies and farmers field. By visiting seed companies, you can also collect the germplasm or varieties that is released by seed company as well as you can also visit farmers field. Farmers are also having their traditional method maintain seed, that is called land races, so you can collect that one from farmers field. Okay, then next one is priority of collection. So the next important step in the germplasm collection is to fix the priority of collection. So some areas of diversity have been threatened more than others, and by the danger due to danger of extinction. So that areas we have to take on priority for collection of plant pieces, where majority of activities conducted. So such area we have to select here. So some crop pieces have more risk of extinction than others. So again, similarly, hence we have to select those area where endangered, those areas are called as endangered area or endangered species, should be given priority for germplasm collection. The next one is agencies of collection. So this task of germplasm collection is undertaken by Crop Research Institute. So normally in countries, within countries, indigenous collections will be collected through Crop Research Institutes, as well as state agriculture universities in collaboration with National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources, which is located at New Delhi, responsible for the collection of indigenous material. And for global, if you want to collect germplasm throughout the world, in that case, in collaboration with International Plant Genetic Resource Institute, which is present at Rome, Italy, that activity will be carried out. The next one is method of collection. So germplasm collections are made in four principal ways. First one is through expedition to the areas or regions of genetic diversity. Then next one is, so through exploration, by visiting those areas or the location where maximum genetic diversity present, you can go do a collection. Second thing is by making personal visit to gene bank center. Then through correspondence. Okay, so through correspondence you can collect the germplasm from your neighbors, relatives, or you can give as a gift, etc. Through that you can get that germplasm. Then the last one is through exchange of material. We have to give some material from our country or our region to other. In that case, we are taking another material, another plant seed or plant part, in the exchange of that material. Next one is method of sampling. So there are two methods for collection of germplasm from the region of diversity, that is random sampling and biased sampling. So random sampling is effective in capturing alleles for biotic and abiotic traces. If you want to make use of that germplasm for biotic and abiotic traces, building resistance, in that case this random sampling will be effective. Another one is non-random or biased sampling, which is useful in collection of morphologically distinct genotype. So this kind of germplasm you can use when you want to get only diversity in morphological character. That time by visual observation we are making a collection of plant species, that is called as a non-random or biased sampling. So both these procedures are adopted to get maximum genetic diversity of a crop basis. The next one is sample size. So the sample size should be such that 95% of total genetic diversity should be captured from the areas of collection. So it is not fixed, but you have to, when you are going for a collection, you have to check ki from that whole area you have covered 95% of area, and from that 95% area you have collected the sample. Hence 50 to 100 individuals you have to select randomly, and from the each individual you have to collect a 50 seed. Okay, so randomly you have to do a selection of 50 to 100 individual, and again per individual you have to collect 50 seeds. So in this picture you can see germplasm variability, which is collected during exploration and collection program at NBPGR in collaboration with other ICAR institute and state agriculture university. So here you can see first picture here, brinjal or eggplant, then here you can see mango, then jawar, maize, and this is coconut you can see here, and this one is citrus. Then next point is merits and demerits. So there are several merits and demerits of this exploration and collection of germplasm. Few of them are explained here. So collection helps in tapping crop genetic diversity and assembling the same at one place. So due to collection we will get a large number of germplasm at a one place. Then second thing is it reduces the loss of genetic diversity due to genetic erosion. Okay, so due to genetic erosion, that is the permanent loss of a particular species, that we can avoid due to exploration and collection. Then material of special interest during exploration trip can be obtained. So whatever required for breeding, that kind of material, special interest material, we can obtain through this exploration trips. Then new plant species during the process of collection will be obtained. So there are also chances of getting a completely new plant species which is not cultivated or which is not already present in our germplasm or gene banks. So such kind of new plant species will be obtained during this collection and exploration trips. Then collection also helps in saving certain genotype from extinction. So due to collection, those genotypes become extinct in coming few years, that we can save. Then next point is demerits. Next one is demerit of exploration and collection. So collection of germplasm, especially from other countries, sometimes leads to entry of new diseases or new insect or new weed. For example, when we imported this Milo Jawar from America, that time along with this Milo Jawar or Milo Sorghum, we got a Parthenium. So this Parthenium, nowadays we are having a major exotic weed. In the same manner, when we imported Norin 10 variety from Philippines, that time also along with this Norin 10 we will get Satyanashi, that is Argimon Mexicana weed, along with that imported material. So that is, there are chances of getting entry of new diseases or new weeds insect into our country. Second thing is collection is a tedious job because the collection has to be made generally from uncultivated areas like hills, mountains, river valleys and forest, where the collector have to face the problems of boarding, lodging and transportation. Therefore, it is a tedious job. Then, in the remote areas, the collector sometimes has encounter with wild animals like elephant, tigers, lions and snakes, which also involves a risk of life. Then, transportation of huge collections also possess difficulties in the exploration and collection. So, whatever material you have collected, that if it is a large one, you can't carry with you. So, you have to stop your exploration trip there and you have to return back. Okay. The next one is a conservation, which is another important step in germplasm activities. So, conservation refers to the protection of genetic diversity of crop plant from genetic erosion. So, there are two important methods of germplasm conservation, that is in situ conservation and another one is ex situ conservation. So, one by one we are going to see into detail. Okay. So, ex situ conservation means off site. So, from original habitat or natural habitat, we are storing that seed away from that natural habitat. Ex means off. Off. Okay. So, in this case, we can either collect a whole plant or part of plant for conservation. So, when we are collecting a whole part, that will be stored in field gene banks, or maybe we are using on-farm conservation, then botanical gardens or arboretum. When we are collecting a part of plant such as seed, pollen, tissue, so we are established already in our country seed gene bank, pollen bank, tissue bank is there, DNA libraries, cryopreservation banks, etc. Okay, then second type is in situ conservation. In means on site. We are conserving that material in their natural habitat. So, for example, we are maintaining biosphere, then national parks we are developed and gene sanctuaries where we can maintain that material as it is. And the third way is preservation. So, in the form of herbarium or museum, we can conserve those material. Okay. So, in situ conservation, it is also called as a on-site conservation or conservation of germplasm under natural habitat. Okay. So, it requires establishment of natural or a biosphere, reserves, national parks or protection of endangered areas or species. So, in this method, wild species and the complete natural and semi-natural ecosystem are preserved together. So, we can maintain wildlife sanctuary, national park, biosphere reserve, then gene sanctuary as well as on-farm conservation we can perform for this in situ conservation. So, national parks, so small reserves covering an area of about 100 to 500 square kilometer we are protecting or reserving here. Then in India we are having in total 104 national parks, which is covering area of about 4501 kilometer square. So, in total 1.23% of the geographical area is covered by these national parks. So, the first national park in India was established in 1936 at Heli in Uttarakhand. Okay. The next one is biosphere reserve. So biosphere reserves cover very large area, often more than 5,000 kilometer square. And in total in India, we are presently having 18 notified biosphere reserves. The next one is gene sanctuaries. So gene sanctuary is nothing but it is an area where plants are conserved. It includes your both biosphere and reserve as well as biosphere reserve as well as national park. So India has set up its first gene sanctuary in the Garo Hills of Meghalaya. Here you can see in the picture. So this portion you can see for wild relatives of citrus. So this Garo Hills of Meghalaya is a gene sanctuary for citrus species, which is conserved or preserved by NBPGR. The next one is on-farm conservation, which is one of the new approach in in-situ conservation of genetic resources, which is focusing on conserving cultivated plant species in farmers' fields. So whatever cultivated material we are having, that is we are every year regenerating, so there will be conservation takes place. So it is nothing but the sustainable management of genetic diversity of locally developed traditional crop varieties with associated with wild and weedy pests, as well as whatever material available with farmer, those maintained from long or too many years by using traditional agriculture, horticulture or agri-silvicultural cultivation system. The next one is merits of in situ conservation. So it conserves the existing genetic diversity in present and allows the evolution to continue. Then new allele and new gene combination would appear with time. Biodiversity is protected. Then natural and cultural heritage is also protected. And ecological integrity is maintained, managed and improved. Then demerits. It is difficult to establish and very difficult to maintain because it requires a large area, specifically hills, mountains, to do the in situ conservation. Therefore, it is difficult to establish and very difficult to maintain. Then it is very prone to biotic and abiotic stresses. So this natural selection will operate in those species that will also result in the loss of genetic diversity and require large area, as well as each protected area will cover only very small portion of total diversity of a crop species, and for that purpose we have to conserve several areas for a single species. The next one is ex situ conservation. It is also referred as a off-site conservation or conservation away from its natural habitat. So preservation of germplasm in gene bank is called as ex situ conservation. So conservation of genes or plant genotype outside their environment of natural occurrence for current or future use also referred as a ex situ conservation. So there are various ways for a conservation of these germplasm, such as seed storage, field gene bank, then we are having botanical or zoological gardens, then pollen storage, DNA storage or cryopreservation. By using any one method we can do a off-site conservation of plant species. So advantages of ex situ conservation, it is possible to to preserve entire genetic diversity of a crop species at a one place. By using ex situ conservation, we will conserve large number of plant species at a one place. So handling of germplasm is also easy, and it is a cheap method, very cheap method of germplasm conservation. So in ex situ conservation, the germplasm is conserved either in the form of seed or in the form of meristem culture. Then seed conservation is relatively safe, which requires minimum pests except coconut, and easy to maintain compared to meristem culture or pollen and DNA. So for seed conservation, we require a glass, tin or plastic container, which is used for a storage purpose. The seeds can be conserved either for long term storage, medium term storage or short term storage condition. Okay, on the basis of the storage conditions, we already studied the types in previous lecture. So here we are going to see the types of seed for storage purpose. So Roberts, in 1973, he classified seeds into two groups for storage purpose, that is orthodox seed and recalcitrant seed. So first one is orthodox seed. So these are the seeds which can be dried to low moisture content and stored at low temperature without losing their viability. So without the loss of viability, we can dry that seeds up to 6 or 7% moisture content, and we can also do a storage of that seed at low temperature. Such as seeds are called as a orthodox seed. So in this group we include a seeds of corn, wheat, rice, carrot, beet, papaya, pepper, chickpea, lentil, soybean, cotton, sunflower, various bean, eggplant and all the brassica group. So the seeds can be dried and stored at low temperature for long period of time are called as orthodox seed. Okay, then second group is recalcitrant seed. So these are the seeds show very drastic loss in viability with decrease in moisture content below 12 to 13%. If we reduce the moisture content below 12%, they lose viability or germination capacity. Such as seeds are called as recalcitrant seed. As well as this group are also not be stored at a low temperature. So they are in this group the crops are included are cocoa, coconut, mango, tea, coffee, rubber, jackfruit and oil palm seeds. So such a seeds we can't conserve in seed banks, so they require a in situ conservation. If seeds are in a recalcitrant form, we require a in situ conservation, while orthodox seeds can be stored in ex situ conservation methods. So crop species which is having this recalcitrant seed, they are stored or conserved in the field gene banks. The next one is seed gene bank. So all gene banks are essentially seed banks, because majority of germplasm is stored in the form of seed. So seed storage in containers of glass, plastic and tin for 50 to 100 years will performed here, because seeds are very convenient for storage, as well as they occupy a small space than the whole plant or plant part. So as I already told you, there are three type of conservation during storage will be carried out, that is short term, that is called as a working collection, medium term, that is called active collection, and long term, that is called as base collection. So short term storage means working collection that can be stored for a short term period, that is up to less than 3 years up to 5 years, at stored at 10 to 15 degree Celsius at 10% moisture level. So generally this kind of material is used for crop improvement program or for breeding purpose. Okay, then next one is medium term storage, that is called as active collection. So such type of accessions are in active collection stored at temperature below 15 degree Celsius and moisture content up to 5%. Okay, the storage is performed for 10 to 15 years, and this type of material we can use for a evaluation, multiplication and distribution purpose. Then the next one is long term storage. It is also referred as a base collection. So germplasm are stored at about minus 20 degree Celsius with 5% moisture content. Okay, and they are only disturbed for regeneration purpose. Okay, so this kind of seed, high quality orthodox seeds are maintained here in long term storage, and they can be stored up to 100 years. Okay, so here we are going to stop. In next lecture we are going to see the remaining part of plant genetic resources or germplasm activities.